you like movies, comic books, science fiction, and more, then you've come to the right place. This is the Rebel Radio Podcast. You can find us at therebelradiopodcast.com, follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and join our Patreon for just $2 a month where you get exclusive episodes. Thank you for listening, and enjoy the show.
He's sorry.
Aaron, like, I was like, what's he doing?
And we're all just staring at the screen.
You know, I was looking at, I was finally checking out that Twisted Tea video that Matt keeps
watching porn.
I thought he was having a pre-cog, you know, vision, and he was predetermining a crime that was about to happen.
Okay. Leave me alone. Okay. Rewind.
This is Mark.
This is Matt.
This is Long, the pre-cog.
Yeah, much better. Yeah.
Boom.
Well, Happy New Year. And we are in 2021. We're in the future, man. You know, like when I was a kid, why are y'all making guns at each other? Is that some sort of gay fucking thing?
Finger blast.
Double lasers.
Yeah. You have your phasers set to like, alien stuff.
Me and Long are a little bit older than you, Matt. So, like, in 1986, when we're watching Transformers the movie, like, 2005 was the fucking future. You know, like, 2021 was, like, 2021 was really the future. And,
yeah,
you know, we thought we'd have flying cars and eye scanners this movie today. Actually, eye scanner technology does exist. But it's really big and bulky and really expensive. So that's why it's not out there yet. But here we are in 2021, and it is the future, but not quite like we probably imagine as children. Does that make sense?
No, but we are living in the corporate dystopia now.
Different kind of dystopia.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, and there's no apocalypse. There's no... Yeah, futuristic type things. There's no precogs, no people reading people's minds, things like that. Like, you know, we thought we might have. But nonetheless, it is 2021. And our first show of the year, and you guys brought it to my attention that 2 years ago in the first show of the year, we did a Tom Cruise movie as well. And I assure you, that was purely coincidental. I did not do that on purpose. So, yeah.
That was the MI2.
Mark, fact, why are you gay? No.
that was the first show with Long's triumphant return as a, at that time, recurring member of the show, moving up to full-time co-host. So.
Right. Yeah. And I had to BS my way through that one because I didn't get to have a copy available for Mission Impossible 2. Couldn't find it anywhere, so I had to kind of like improvise. It was a mission I accepted.
Your mission, if you choose to accept
my only copy of Mission Impossible 2 self-destructed, so I couldn't give it a proper feature look.
Nice.
So, how's y'all's start to the new year so far for you guys?
Relaxing. Getting the batteries recharged.
I've been on vacation. I ain't done shit. I mean, I took Christmas stuff down, sure, and cleaned the house, but I played a lot of Star Wars Galaxies. I took the advantage of being off and having time to play. Ran a few errands here and there, but I ain't done shit. And you know what? And I'm proud to say it. Sometimes that's what vacations are for.
This is true.
You know, going back Monday morning, it's going to be back to the grind.
I bought a bunch of voodoo movies. They were on sale. So I bought the all the Rocky films. Yep. Watched I watched one. And I was gonna watch. I was gonna watch two.
Probably could have bought a Blu-ray set for even cheaper than what they were on Vudu, though.
I only paid $30 for all the movies.
I think I got my Rocky Blu-ray set for like $20.
Really?
Yeah,
that's really good.
That's usually a cheaper set on Blu-ray because it's been out so long.
Okay. Because I must have been thinking about the last time I saw it, because I could have sworn I saw like a $60 price tag on it at one point. And so I had it in my mind that it was like way more expensive.
Sometimes you got to watch those Vudu sales. They're not always the best deals, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, since we're talking about movies, we might as well talk about download this. Nice segue, Matt.
Yeah, there we go. I guess I'll continue.
Yeah.
I also watched Indiana Jones. I went ahead and they had the trilogy on sale for like, I think it was like $15 on Vudu or something like that. I forget, but I bought it because I was like, it's Indiana Jones. Why not? And the wife has not seen any Indiana Jones films. So we watched Raiders of the Lost Ark. Yeah, has not seen any.
What have you been doing until the last 15 years? You're not training her.
Watching Grease. Watching Grease.
Up until
Wild Things.
Little Women.
Little Women. Up until this year, she had just barely seen, she hadn't seen Lord of the Rings until this year. I had her watch the trilogy earlier this year.
Amazon, you could have gotten all six Rocky movies for $25 on Amazon.
You could have saved $5.
So anyways, what did she think of Raiders?
She liked it. She said that she didn't think it was a awesome, you know, movie, but she said she really did like it and she wants to watch the rest. So I guess to her it sounds like a B rating. Which I get it, you know, maybe you're used to like different kinds of action, you know, but watching it, I remember watching that, you know, when I was closer to around 10 years old or so. And, I was entertained by it, just the people's faces melting off, the skeletons with the snakes crawling out of them. I liked it. I felt like the movie moved at a pace
of all time.
Yeah. That's my favorite Indiana Jones film, Raiders of the Lost Ark. I just think it's cool. But you know, I'm glad that she enjoyed it, and you know, she's interested in watching the rest. So that's a start, and get on to that. You know,
my first Indiana Jones movie was Temple of Doom. I saw that in the theaters.
Kalima.
And I was like, man, I was short round. I was like, I can relate to that character. So I'm like, cool. Harrison Ford is my Dr. Jones.
Dr. Jones.
Hey, you call him Dr. Jones. Anyways, anything else?
Playing a bunch of Rainbow Siege and, of course, watch the first episode of Cobra Kai.
Oh, how was it?
It was good. It was good. They ended it on a cliffhanger, which I thought was cool. But you know, I feel like they did have some of the high school stuff in there, but they only put a minimal amount in there, and looks like they focused more on Johnny and Daniel and Kreese at the beginning, and of course, you know, Miguel. You obviously tell from the trailer, Miguel's banged up, so quite a bit of time on him. Didn't watch anything past that, but maybe tomorrow, watch the second episode. Hopefully get halfway through it by the end of next week.
I didn't watch it, but I glanced at the episodes. I noticed that on Netflix, there's some 39, 40-minute episodes now instead of little 20, 25-minute episodes. There's a few of them that are a little bit longer.
Yeah. Your turn, Mark. Mark, can you hear me?
Yeah. Oh. I didn't watch a lot, but I started playing Ghost of Tsushima. Tsushima is how you say it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
What a beautiful game.
Yeah.
I know I always say I get amazed by graphics. I thought The Last of Us 2 is a great looking game, but this is a really, really fantastic looking game from the colors and the way it's laid out. The Kurosawa mode is really cool to play in black and white.
Yeah.
I haven't gotten super far into it, but story-wise, it seems kind of a little typical so far. You know, him avenging his honor kind of story. So it feels like I've maybe been there, done that kind of story so far as summarized go. But that's not going to keep me from playing it. I mean, hopefully it gets better.
What do you think of the sword play? How does it feel? It's
fantastic. You know, slicing and dicing people makes me feel like a fucking samurai. and it's well handled. It's not overly complicated as far as combos and things like that. I did have to turn up the brightness because it was a little dark in some parts in the game, I felt. I was like, okay, my old eyes can't see. So I had to turn the brightness up. And I know they say sometimes that ruins the graphics, but I don't care. I need to be able to see the game. But excellent voice work so far. Really glad I've purchased this because I wanted to play it ever since I saw the trailer. And I kind of wanted to wait and see what people thought about it. And overall, it's getting good reviews. And a really, really cool game so far. And it's a PS4 exclusive, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So too bad for Xbox people.
Yeah, and what's so fascinating about this game is that it's made by an American gaming developer, and the Japanese gamers love it. It's been selling out over there in Japan because it's the first game or film or interactive media that's portrayed like medieval Japan. Because every time Japan portrays samurais, it's always in, 17th century on up, but never, in that medieval period. So,
yeah.
And even then, a lot of historical Japanese history professors say that it's very accurate too, compared to Japanese samurai movies made in Japan.
I found some mechanics like the following the wind to go over to your next destination. I thought that was kind of a unique way to do it. I actually did not realize it was an open world game until I bought it. I was like, oh, this is open world. I thought it was more,
linear.
I don't know what not so much linear or more focused than open world. But it's still cool. I don't mind it being open world. But so far, really good stuff, man. And then that's really all I've played this week. Other than Galaxy, I'm trying to think if we watched anything this week. I didn't watch much. Now that The Mandalorian is over, there hasn't been much that's interested me. I mean, I will watch Cobra Kai once I get a chance to sit down and watch it. But that's about all I can think of, really.
Okay. Well, for my download this, let's see. My brain is just desperate to find something to just decompress from this crazy quarter, actually from the crazy year in general. Now that my vacations are restored for the new year, I think I qualify for a total of 5 weeks. It's nothing compared to Mark's 3 months of vacation, but
no, I get 5 weeks.
Oh, okay. So anyhow, started off the new year and dang, I spent yesterday watching two Tom Cruise movies. I don't know why I was in a Tom Cruise kick yesterday, but sat through our feature movie, which we'll talk about later on. But and I finally saw Mission Impossible Fallout yesterday, and it is a good movie. I thoroughly enjoyed it more than Ghost Protocol. Ghost Protocol was meh. When I watched it, good action, but it just didn't wow me all that much. I totally skipped Rogue Nation, so I don't know how good that movie is. But Fallout was really good.
You probably should watch Rogue Nation because it'll make you appreciate Fallout more.
Yeah. Yeah, there's some story threads from there, I think.
Yeah, oh, right? Big time. Big time. Oh,
and Rebecca Ferguson. Oh, she's so beautiful.
Yeah, so Fallout's an amazing flick. I mean, that helicopter chase at the end of the movie is top notch.
Yeah. Yeah, the fight at the end of the chase too was good. But my biggest gripe was the guy who plays Lane, Solomon Lane, I think that's his name.
Yeah.
He has zero charisma. The bearded dude has zero charisma. I don't. He looks menacing, but I don't. That villain has like no charisma to me.
You need to watch Rogue Nation.
Yeah, I'm sure. I mean, he was in Spectre. He was in that movie Spectre. That same actor, Sean Harris, and he was delivering that line about, you know, Spectre being a, you know, the true organization, was delivering that monologue to Daniel Craig. Still zero charisma delivery, you know. So I'm not impressed by that guy. I don't care what show he's from that got him that role, but not impressed. Play a little bit of Ghost of Tsushima also. Play a little bit of Witcher 3. My brain was just in ADD mode all day. I just couldn't settle down. And fucking bought Animal Crossing today and played a couple of hours of that today on the Switch. So I had a smorgasbord of things to do today and yesterday. But yeah, that's my download disc.
Animal Crossing. You still play that a lot on the the GameCube. Was it the GameCube? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, the first one was on the GameCube, I think.
Yeah, and it came with its own memory card just for the game because there was so much stuff in it. That's right. I remember that. Cool, good stuff. Well, let's get into today's featured film then, our first movie to kick off the new year. And that is Tom Cruise's Minority Report. Well, he stars in it. It's Steven Spielberg directed it. And Long, you had never seen this before.
Nope. Never seen it. But I finally sat down and watched it. I hope Mark is still recording on Zencaster at least. Mm-hmm. Looks like his... Okay, good.
Yep.
But anyhow, who wants to summarize? I'll summarize the damn thing. Just to prove I actually watched it.
There we go.
Tom Cruise, the basic gist of the movie is Tom Cruise works for the pre-crime division, government-sanctioned organization that arrests people before they commit the crime, which is a felony, basically. Because I think they only go after murders, right? Murders and rapes?
Yeah.
Yeah. And they go arrest people based on what three psychic people see in their visions, and they're very accurate. But anyways, eventually Tom Cruise is like the torchbearer, the shield bearer of the program. He believes in it wholeheartedly, but he has a couple of demons of his own that he has to wrestle with. And the crux of the movie is that he gets accused of a pre-crime he didn't commit. He gets accused of murder or witness to a murder, and so the whole movie revolves around him trying to clear his name or trying to stop this fate from actually happening. So he goes in and gets his eyes surgically removed in order to access the base and try to kidnap one of the psychics, and he's a man on the run from cops and jetpacks and hover cars, and it's all over the place. But people consider this a cyberpunk movie, and I do kind of see that.
Well, the director, Spielberg, didn't want to focus too much on the futuristic stuff. He wanted to focus on the story, so that's why there's a little less cyberpunk stuff in there. Yeah, there's definitely the elements, but like you noted too, it's just not super evident in your face all the time.
But there's enough.
But
yeah. No, go ahead, Long.
So anyways, eventually through the movie, he finds out that he's set up, and the true villain of the whole piece was the guy who created the pre-crime division in the first place. Poor Colin Farrell gets killed. Actually started liking that character. And, by the end of the movie, Tom Cruise's character absolves himself, and, the guy who set him up, who framed him, was killed himself. So, yeah, Minority Report. And basically, the Minority Report is trying to find, okay, that one piece of memory that proves that that there could be a flaw in the system of pre-crime.
The pre-cogs don't always agree. And while they always show the majority report, the minority report is whenever they disagree and they see something different. And so, like you said, you have to finding that minority report that is always deleted whenever Agatha supersedes everything, and getting that from the source and proving your innocence.
Yeah.
I just think it's great how they make you invest yourself in this system. I think they do a good job of making you believe this system works, and that's how they have to get the audience engaged. They have to make sure the audience is believing in the system as much as Tom Cruise's character John Anderton is believing in it. And Anderton.
What a weird name.
Yeah, it went to Anderson in, 1995 when they wrote the first script for it. And then they went back to Anderton, which was the original script based off the 1957 novel, Minority Report. But whenever he throws the ball and Colin Farrell catches it, it's like, why did you catch it? You know, oh, well, it was going to fall. But it didn't fall because you caught it. And he's asking, why do you know, how do you know these murders are going to happen anyways? You don't know them for sure. And arresting people before it happened, you're arresting innocent people. So
when I saw that part, that whole little debate, it's like, oh, you caught the ball. I'm like, get the fuck out of here. You know, I know he's just using it as an example, you know, but it's like, yeah, it's kind of funny. This story, elements of the story was taken from this movie and kind of made into, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, Marvel Comics, mega event, Civil War II, where, Captain Marvel was stopping all this stuff from happening, you know, arresting superheroes or supervillains from committing their crime.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyways, sorry, a little segue.
No, cool. That's a cool fact.
It's funny. I saw this movie 3 weeks before it even came out. I got to go to a press screening because I had a friend that worked for the school paper at the University of Houston, I think it was, or he knew somebody or something. We went to a press screening of this film, and it had no credits on it yet. They hadn't attached them to the reels. So it's kind of cool. And we got free Minority Report posters, and my initial reaction to this was I really liked this movie a lot. And then I went back and saw it in theaters when it came out. If I had one beef with this film, it's the somewhat anticlimactic exposition style ending. You know, again, that's a Spielberg, and then we're focusing on story instead of necessarily action and the science fiction of it. But when the science fiction in this film does hit, it hits hard, and it's pretty badass. You know, with the jetpacks and stuff like that, and the moving of his eyes and all that, the spider drones and all. I mean, it's some really cool sci-fi in it when it is happening, but it's all set around a story they were trying to tell. And I tend to really like science fiction like this that is a bit grounded in a possible reality where the science fiction is not necessarily used to tell the story, but is a complement to the story. If that makes sense.
Yeah. I think that's a perfect way of describing it, and I think then that's what they were going for too. I remember watching this in theaters. My mom is actually a huge Tom Cruise fan, so we had to go see Minority Report, and I remember being super entertained by it, very blown away. You know, in 2002, I was what, like 16 years old? I think I was 16. Yeah, 16 mm-hmm. years old. I still like the movie, the jetpacks. Whenever I first saw the jetpacks, I thought that they were really cool. Now I'm like, man, shouldn't they be a little faster? I don't know. Maybe I'm just criticizing them a little.
Shouldn't the back of their legs be burning really?
Yeah.
Burning off.
Why are they not singeing your legs?
Yeah. Are they wearing fireproof pants, you know, to keep their legs from burning up? Mm-hmm. You know? Watching that. Seeing their legs bend backwards towards the vapor, you know? It's like, hey, they're not burning
their
up.
Their arms off because they're like, just getting jerked around by the force of the jetpack. I like the Lexus in here. The scene in the factory, the fight scene, I always thought was cool because of the stun gun that shot the just basically a force push blast.
Yeah,
and the way you had to prime it, he's like flipping it around like a futuristic gunslinger of some sorts. And man, Tom Cruise, we know Tom Cruise likes running. I guess they had to make a point of him being like the fastest man alive or something in this film.
Why is that? Why is it that every movie he's running except for Top Gun? You know,
I know he's flying. He doesn't have to run in Top Gun. He flies. But I think they maybe it was part of the way of a way to tie it into the child's. I think that's the only thing that's not part of the book, really, is the child, you know, his son being taken from him and, you know, wishing that he was, you know, fast enough to catch up to him. You know, you get the sense of feeling that if pre-crime was, you know, working at this point, maybe that wouldn't have happened. And maybe his son would have been alive, and you feel for him, you know, you feel for him because he lost his kid and he carries that demon with him, just can't shake it. And that's what ultimately gets him caught by Colin Farrell, possession of narcotics or some other hardened street drug that he's got on him. But yeah, this movie, you know, I like it. I like it. I wonder what happens afterwards. You know, do they just release everybody? Because, you know, that Dr. Henneman, who for some reason decides that she has to kiss Tom Cruise's character. And it makes me wonder, like, maybe they're like, she's like, okay, I'll come on board with the film, but I get to kiss Tom Cruise. And she's like friggin' old as heck. but yeah, she
tried to put that tongue in him.
Yeah, man. She's like, I'm kissing Tom Cruise.
One thing I love about Spielberg, you know, he's done a lot of movies. Like, if you think about it, he's given us a certain vision of what the future may look like or could look like. And, you know, from Close Encounters to E.T. to Minority Report to his War of the Worlds to Ready Player One. I mean, Spielberg has given quite a vision of what things he could do. And Minority Report, I think, has the most realistic feel of what a feature could be. You know, black market eyes and scanners and, you know, maybe not the pre-cog stuff, but some of the other stuff around it. The world that this movie exists in feels like it could really happen, you know?
I think so, because it's also got that element from Firefly in it where you have, like, futuristic weapons, but then you have you know, your powder firearms like you have today. You've got the cool non-lethal weapons and the six sticks that make people projectile throw up. Something that would envy you know, mirror The Exorcist. A little bit of pea soup in there, yeah, you've got a mix of those weapons, futuristic and, you know, primitive. What would probably be viewed as a primitive weapon. You've got both, and Firefly does that too, and I think that's probably a more accurate depiction, you know, some people may have the cool ray guns, and then other people are like, you know what, I can't afford the cool ray gun, you know, I can't afford the Apple 12, you know, I gotta have the Apple 7 Plus, whatever. So I only have the firing pin guns. Yeah, you got a lot of character actors in this movie too. That's one thing I noticed. A lot of people are like, I know him, I know that guy, but I don't know their names. And there's like 50 of them in this film. The guy who...
Well, there's that scene, there's that disturbing scene where he goes to the crime alley doctor to get his eyes removed.
Yeah.
By Peter Stormare.
Yes.
And his one lady nurse was picking up Tom Cruise while he's under anesthetic. He's grabbing his ass and stuff, you know?
Yeah. I think Tom
Cruise... She was grabbing his butt.
Tom Cruise always, I felt like he went out and goes out of his way to make sure people know that he is a man that loves to be fondled by other women. I mean, he made Eyes Wide Shut to after the gay rumors showed to prove how un-gay he was. He's like, well, we're just, me and Nicole Kidman are going to sleep around a bunch on film. That's how I'll show you I'm not gay. And then, you know, he's jumping up.
Nothing to do with Minority Report.
Well, that's something to do with Tom Cruise. Saying, I think maybe he maybe pushed that into the film, maybe. Because it's like, what the point? You know, what's the point of that? What does it drive the film at all? Or maybe it's comic relief. Could be something simple like that. But it's just
speculative. I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm just saying,
what
maybe
are you talking about?
Maybe he wanted that
rambling. He started talking about Eyes Wide Shut. What are you talking about, Matt?
I came back around long.
Okay.
I came around the cul-de-sac. I did go, but I can't. I'm back. And I'm back.
Okay. Yeah. That was a big-ass cul-de-sac. Damn.
This is Texas.
Everything's okay. Big. Right. Okay. Well.
The other character actors. Yeah.
Well, there was Max von Sydow, Colin Farrell, Tom Cruise, Peter Stormare, Tom Cruise.
Yeah. Tom Cruise again.
I don't recognize any other actors.
Well, I recognize the, you know, the warden kind of dude that's watching the...
Yeah.
He's from Holes and different films, of course.
My favorite movie that actor's in was Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Yeah. And he also played the doctor from The Incredible Hulk with Edward Norton.
That's right. Mr. Blue.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. What's his name? The actor's name?
I would have to pull up IMDb.
Yeah. But anyhow, let's see here. My favorite scenes of the movie were definitely the jetpack scenes where they were trying to attempt to arrest him. And I also like the scene of the self-driving highway vehicles.
Oh, that was neat.
That's very unique.
Frank Grillo is in this movie as one of the cops.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Crossbones is in it. Who's that one guy? There was a guy in this film, the guy that played Neil McDonald.
Yeah.
Neil
McDonald. Yeah.
I always remember him as the bad guy from the Arrow show. He was one of the bad guys. I remember Steve Harris. Steve Harris was from Diary of a Mad Black Woman.
I first saw him in Star Trek First Contact one of the bridge officers who got turned into a Borg.
He's one of top billing. He got top billing for this movie.
Yeah, and I remember seeing him in the trailers. I was like, hey, he's moving up from Star Trek. Mm-hmm. So,
man, well, how much money did this movie cost? I'm looking it up right now. And I wonder. So the budget was $102 million. And opening weekend was $35 million. It ended up grossing $132 million. So I only made $30 million. in the box office, but it looks like worldwide it did really good. Overseas,
what's a worldwide?
Worldwide is 358 mil.
So yeah, that's another 100 million.
Yeah. So, yeah, that
it was a success.
Yeah, sure. It was a fairly big success. Yeah, I mean Spielberg, it's got to be, but you know, nominated for an Oscar. Probably best sound editing. I didn't expect that, but I guess because of all the futuristic sounds and the rewinding and stuff of the magic fingers, magic finger plugs.
Other than that, yeah, there was a lot going on in this film visually. I also like the spiders, the cybernetic spider scene.
That was cool.
That was pretty cool. And it's definitely a really good science fiction mystery movie, for sure. And those are my thoughts. How about you, Mark? We've been espousing, what are your favorite scenes? What is stuff you didn't like about the movie?
I like the spider drones in the apartment building where they're scanning everybody. I think that's really cool. And then he's hiding his new eyes and going under the water. And it's all really futuristically trippy and kind of tense. I like that whole scene, though, in that building. I think that's cool. I think that this is I like the film a lot. I wish the ending was a little bit more exciting, but it is what it is. Max von Sydow gives a good performance as the leader of the pre-cog. And I guess I really didn't see that he was the bad guy. You know, that was kind of a surprise. But I think this movie does a good job of not giving clues as to who the bad guy was. It wasn't supposed to be like, they didn't sell this like a twist in any movie. So I think when I originally watched it, I wasn't looking for a twist. And I was like, oh, there's a twist. I think that's cool. But I do think this is, I think it's top-notch Steven Spielberg. I think Cruise is really good in the movie. You know, one thing about Spielberg, you know, he doesn't ever mail anything in. I mean, say what you want, even we mentioned earlier in the show, Indiana Jones, even Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. Yeah, maybe it's not as good as the other Indiana Jones films, but it's still not mailed in. You know, it's still a fun movie to watch for the most part. And that's one thing I love about Spielberg. And I know if I go to the movie theater and I watch a Steven Spielberg film and it's starring Tom Cruise, I'm going to be thoroughly entertained. And Minority Report certainly does that. And, I give this movie a solid A. I think it's a good film. I think it's really well done. And I'm kind of like Matt, always wanting to know what happens to the world after Precog was dissolved, you know? I think there could have been more stories to tell in this world.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what a... The aftermath is definitely a big question mark that I think, you know, maybe would have warranted a sequel. I mean, me and Long were talking, you know, about the money that it made, and it didn't make a ton of money here. You know, it made 30 million here. That was its profit, but overseas, you know, over 200 million overseas. So there was definitely a market for it.
Yeah, the movie overall was a success. Yeah.
So, yeah, I think it's an A. You know, I was definitely much higher on it whenever I first saw it. But, you know, that's just everything. You know, you rewatch it, it's like eating a candy bar. You know, that first bite into a candy bar is awesome. And you take another bite, and, you know, it's maybe not as good as the first, but you still enjoy it. That's kind of how it is for me on this one.
And
very enjoyable.
And Cruz and Spielberg both worked for free of this film. They took box office takes instead of salary. Yeah, because they wanted to keep the film under budget and make it as spectacular as they could.
Yeah.
Those two working together. A lot of success.
Well, they only did two movies. War of the Worlds. And
these are the only two?
Yeah, they only did two movies together.
I figured because of those two that there was probably at least a third or a fourth. Man.
Spielberg doesn't really have a go-to actor because he usually just works with one or two actors with two movies at the most. The other actor he's worked twice with, besides Harrison Ford in the Indiana Jones movies, was Richard Dreyfuss for Close Encounters and Jaws.
Dreyfuss.
And Tom Cruise. I can't think of any other films where he had multiple same leading actor.
Jeff Goldblum in both.
Besides Harrison Ford.
Jeff Goldblum in both Jurassic Park movies.
Yeah. Yeah. He was so. Jeff Goldblum was so good in JP1 that Spielberg wanted him in part two.
Tom Hanks. He's done several movies.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Hanks.
Yeah, Catch Me If You Can. And.
Terminal? Was he in the.
Terminal? Yeah.
Saving Private Ryan.
Bridge of Spies. Yeah. Wow. Yeah, Saving Private Ryan. So, yeah, Tom Hanks has the record now for the most Spielberg movies, I think, besides Harrison Ford.
Yep.
So, too.
Not not a bad go-to actor, if that's your go-to actor.
I'm going to rank this movie between A-, B+. It's touch and go for me for Minority Report. There are some slow moments. Yeah.
There are some slow moments. And I think some people, they may want more background story. But I think we're still in this age.
Oh, I think we've got plenty of background story for Tom Cruise's character.
Yeah.
His motivations. Yeah, it felt like they were beating it into our heads, you know?
Very, very sold. He's very, very much a true believer of it.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
any poo. Yep.
Yeah. So, let's guess that's our roundup for the feature movie. So, on to the top five. and our top five list, we are going to talk about five of our most anticipated. Doesn't have to be just movies, right?
Well, I did movies. I mean, I just, you know.
Oh, okay. Well, I included shows and movies.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Top five 2021 stuff that we're looking forward to. I'll start the list off, and then Matt, you can go next, and Mark, you can finish it off.
Okay.
My number five most anticipated series or movies for 2021 is The Book of Fett. The spinoff for The Mandalorian. Definitely looking forward to that show. And that's my number five. Go ahead, Matt. What's your number five?
I did all movies, and number five for me is Matrix 4. I am tempted to see where this goes after I thought it was completely done and over with. I want to see what they do with Neo and what's going on with the Matrix now. Why is it back?
Yeah.
And what's the story about?
Yeah. Yeah. Revolutions was pretty damn clear cut.
Yeah.
Cut and dry.
Yeah. That's,
but then again, they did mention in Revolutions that there was more than one Neo that appeared in front of the, whatchamacallit?
The Oracle.
Not the Oracle. The guy, the architect.
Yeah. The architect.
Yeah. What's your number five, Mark?
Okay. I was a little lost. I got y'all cut out for a minute there. So my freaking internet's crapping out tonight. But at number five, I have a, believe it or not, a Tom Cruise movie. You talked about finally seeing Fallout, and Fallout was incredible. So I'm looking forward to see where they go with that series. I've actually thoroughly enjoyed the Mission Impossible series overall. So I'm looking forward to Mission Impossible 7, which should be out later this year, and seeing how that goes.
Where does Top Gun lie for you, Mark?
What?
Does Top Gun 2 in that list?
It'll be in the list eventually.
Oh, okay. Ooh, I accidentally spoiled it for Mark. My number four, my number four anticipated show.
I already know what your number one is.
Winter Soldier. Winter Soldier and Falcon. Or do you? Winter Soldier and the Falcon Marvel series. I'm looking forward to seeing where the Winter Soldier goes. I feel like I'm in the minority when it comes to Bucky's character. I'm fascinated by where he goes, what his redemption arc is, mm-hmm. since the fallout of Civil War and Captain America 3, was it?
Was Captain America 3?
Yeah, because they never really touched up on him given the chance to develop as a you know, former KGB spy, you know, and well, how he and deals with it.
Hopefully Sebastian Stan learned how to act a little better, too.
Yeah.
He's my one beat. He's just not a very good actor. But he has
so? I don't see.
He hasn't really had to act so far.
I don't
far,
see him though. In enough stuff.
It's mostly just been action yeah. scenes so far. Now he's going to carry a television show. He's going to have to act more, so hopefully he does a better job.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Matt.
Number four, I Have No Time to Die. Definitely looking forward to next installment of James Bond and the cool gadgets that I see in the trailer and want to see it. So hopefully I get to in 2021.
As opposed to Jesse Ventura's No Time to Bleed.
Yes.
No, I'm joking.
my number four is probably Long's number one, and that's Godzilla vs. Kong.
What? Spoiler. Like, no.
I guess I'm not super excited yet because I haven't seen a trailer. It's like, show us some footage already. But I will watch Godzilla and King Kong throw down any day of the week. So let's bring it and see what happens.
Yeah. My number three is Bond, No Time to Die. I want to see how Daniel Craig finishes out his run as Bond and see what the future holds. Go ahead, Matt.
I have Godzilla versus Kong.
My boy.
I want to see these two titans go against each other and see how epic the showdown is. I think it's going to be badass.
Yeah. What's your number two, Mark?
All right. Number three?
Oh.
Three. Yeah, three.
The three? My bad.
I have
I'm not good at this.
I have Dune. I know nothing about Dune. I saw the David Lynch film. It's okay, you know, but I know this has, but then I saw the trailer for the new one and like, it looks pretty fucking cool. I actually really want to see it. Really great cast. We'll see what happens. I'm excited to see Dune when it comes out.
Nice. My number two is WandaVision. I want to see where this piece of the Marvel puzzle fits. Definitely want to see how Vision survives his deal from the Infinity War, because they never really did show him reappear. He might have appeared somewhere in the background during the final scene, but I didn't see Vision. But that's my number two, WandaVision.
Number two for me, I have Top Gun Maverick. I just know this movie is going to be a ton of fun. It's going to be awesome. It looks great from the trailer. I think it's going to be a slam dunk, and I can't wait to see it.
My number two, kind of a lot of the same reasons Matt put on his list, The Matrix 4. Like, I don't see why we're getting it. I don't understand how we're getting it. But by golly, yes, I said by golly, I'm going to watch the shit out of it just because I do think the Wachowski, I guess, are sisters now, are visionaries, and I'm curious to see what they do. I trust in them enough to think they'll bring us something unique and new, just like they did with the original Matrix. And I know Long wants to knock their Speed Racer movie, but I think it's a fun, enjoyable movie.
I don't knock it. I don't know where you get this impression that I hate it. I own the movie.
I think they are visionary directors, and I hope they bring us something new with The Matrix 4.
I don't hate the movie. Where did you get that from?
Text about it. You like hate it or something. We're going to cover that damn movie this year.
No. Okay, fine. Well, I'm all for it. Jeez. Well, my number one is Godzilla versus Kong. No, fine. No, fine. You called me out.
No. I can't fucking believe it. It's amazing.
Sorry, just lean into it. Lean into your role.
There's no way that's
but
number
no.
one.
What? I am shocked. But my number one also, to go along with it, is the Godzilla anime TV series that's coming out on Netflix in April. I am so on board. I hope the anime series does better than the movie trilogy that came out a couple years back. And yeah, I hope this will wipe away the pretentiousness of that CGI trilogy that came out on Netflix.
The second,
because oh my god!
Oh, I just realized the next six episodes of that Transformers anime is out.
Oh, okay. I've heard some good reviews on it. People like it better than the first season, but we'll see. Let's go ahead, Matt.
And for me, I've been waiting for a follow-up forever. I had these toys as a kid, and it's Ghostbusters Afterlife. I cannot wait. I am ecstatic. I had Ghostbusters everything as a kid. There are pictures of me that my mom has when she just bought me everything Ghostbusters on the shelf because I was the only child. So I had the proton pack, the trap. I had the ball shooter gun from Ghostbusters 2. And then I had the shirt and the pants that they had at the store. Not the actual jumpsuit, but like a Ghostbusters long sleeve shirt. And Ghostbusters, you know, Gene, they have like a little Ghostbuster patch there. But I love Ghostbusters. And I still haven't really forgiven my mom for giving away my Ghostbusters toys to the Goodwill. And I'm kind of ticked about that. She gave away my proton pack and the gun. And she's like, "Oh, I didn't think you'd want it anymore." Oh man, I can't wait to see it. I think it's going to be great.
We could tell. I don't know. The trailer didn't do enough for me.
I felt the pain.
I don't know. I mean, I'll see it, but the trailer didn't do enough for me. At number one, I'm pulling along. I have a tie, and my tie is Top Gun Maverick and No Time to Die. I love the James Bond franchise, so I'm looking forward to seeing Daniel Craig's final outing as James Bond. And then Top Gun Maverick, I've been waiting since a whole year to see it. It keeps getting pushed back. God damn it, COVID. I just want to see Top Gun Maverick. I don't give a fuck. Even if I have to watch it at home streaming, I want to see that movie. So I'm excited for it. And that's nice. My number one movies I'm looking forward to this year. But yeah. Good top five. As far as news, it was a holiday week. So about the only thing that really happened this week was Warner Brothers is fast-tracking Wonder Woman 3. I'm going to guess, if I was to say that this means Cleopatra's not going to happen anytime soon, because if they want her to start on Wonder Woman 3 right away, she's pretty much going to have to do it so she has time to do Star Wars. So we may never get Gal Gadot's Cleopatra movie, but that's okay. Hopefully Wonder Woman 3, though, is better than Wonder Woman 2.
Yeah.
That's really it. I mean, yep. No news this week. Like you said, it's the holidays, New Year, Christmas, and New Year's. So that happens. There should be news hopefully next week. But
I keep hearing conflicting rumors that Mandalorian season 3 is still coming out this year.
Of what?
Have you heard about that?
No.
Mandalorian season 3 is still coming out. They're going to try to make it this year still.
Oh, yeah. I don't...
There ain't no way.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, they said Christmas 2021. So.
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I thought that was Book of Fett.
Well, that is supposed to be out, too.
So, yeah. Oh, okay. Oh.
So, I'm sure it'll happen.
Maybe we get both. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna stay in the future next week, and talk a pretty fun science fiction movie. Not quite as dark as Minority Report. A little bit more colorful, a little bit more crazy, and that is The Fifth Element.
Every 5,000 years.
Remove the shield.
When the three planets are in eclipse, the black hole, like a door, is open. Evil comes, spreading terror and chaos.
There's nothing that can stop this.
There is only one thing.
Perfect.
The Mondachiwan have in their possession the only weapon to defeat evil. Four elements. Gathered around a fifth.
Hello.
Corbin, sweetheart. You got broken fingers, you can't punch my number?
Hi, Mom.
Welcome on. Have a nice day.
Major Dallas, you've been selected for a mission of the utmost importance.
What mission?
Save the world.
Is that thing solid?
Unbreakable.
Good. Order the stone.
I don't know. And even if I did know, I wouldn't tell somebody like you.
Nowhere else to go.
Surprised we hadn't covered yet, because I think we talked about it before and people have asked about it.
Yeah.
And we just covered it, sort of kept finding the right time to do it, I guess. But of course, starring Bruce Willis and directed by Luc Besson, gave us one of our first films to star Mia Jovovich. So it brought her into the acting world, and Gary Oldman in a great performance. So it should be a fun one to talk about next week on the show. And then coming up in a couple weeks, we got Long's birthday pick, which I don't even know what it is yet. But some good stuff as we move into 2021. We got a lot of cool movies planned for people. You can always suggest stuff to us on our Facebook page, our group, movies you want us to cover.
Yes.
We're going to hit 250 episodes here in a few months. Speaking of Indiana Jones, we probably will do Temple of Doom for episode 250. So it should be a fun year on the Rebel Radio Podcast, and we thank everyone for their support so far, and hopefully look forward to their continued support going into the new year. That's it. That's all we got. As always, go to the RebelRadioPodcast.com. That's where you can find us. This has been Mark.
This has been Matt.
This is Long, the precognitive psychic dude, bro.
So do you see a bright future for the podcast?
I see murder. No, I'm joking. Yes, I see a very, very bright future. Ooh.
Well, until next week, thank you all for listening. And remember, as always, just go there and do it.
Just go there and do it.
Do it.